A lot of stuff has sort of happened in the world. I wanted to get your take on it. We've had the oil and the Gulf crisis thing going on. We've seen this health care reform thing sort of stomped through Congress. And now we've got our government suing Arizona, which, according to my interpretation of the Bill of Rights and the 11th Amendment, isn't even legal. What's your take on all that stuff?
Oh, man. You know, keeping track of current events is it's exhausting, isn't it? There's just so much happening all the time. And, you know, it's a very dynamic society we live in, and getting more and more connected, you know, to the world every day. There's just so much news, you know, and so many different spins on a topic. It's hard to really focus on one thing, you know. And to really understand a topic, you really do need to focus on it, you know, completely enough to read all the opinions and the history of the situation and come up with your own answer to it all. And honestly, I've just been so wrapped up in what we're doing right now. I haven't had a lot of inspiration, I guess, to look into a lot of that stuff. I've kind of buried my head in the sand, so to speak, and been, you know, focusing on making the record.
Outside of the music itself, what's sort of been the topic of conversation around the Queensryche camp this spring?
Well, mostly it's been dealing with our industry and what a slump it's in, you know, due to the economic crisis worldwide, and, you know, trying to make heads or tails of what to do, you know, with regards to records. Or the record industry is basically dead now, and the live industry is really being threatened, of course, by the economic crisis that's going on. It's just crisis after crisis, you know.
Yeah, it's really difficult when they have, like, these big festivals, like Mayhem just rolled through here, where they get 10,000 people for 12 bands like this, and they consider that a success. And I'm like, that used to be a small show in a medium-sized venue for one of these bands. Our economy is really in trouble.
Yeah, it is. It's a very sad time, very, very frustrating for everyone, I think. You know, it's a trickle-down effect. You know, I see so many businesses closing and spaces for rent, and, you know, everybody's feeling it from the top down. You know, it's a difficult time.
With that in mind, again, because you're sort of the social anthropologist, if you will, I've been waiting to ask you this question. If you could sit down for an evening with anyone, past, present, dead or alive, for an evening of conversation and some insania, and just talk about things, who would it be?
Oh, well, gosh. Well, I'd probably try to invite, like, a dinner party, you know, a number of different people to sit and, you know, just, you know, throw ideas out. But I think the people that are working in the sciences would be very interesting to talk to at this point, because there's so much happening in regards to, you know, transportation and alternative fuels and things like that. To me, that seems to be one of the main topics of interest to most people, because it affects everybody, you know, how we're going to pry ourselves away from so much fossil fuel use, you know, and getting into some, you know, greener, cleaner fuel choices, because everybody is feeling it, you know. And the Middle East, of course, is so indoctrinated with religion, you know, they can't get themselves above that and past that enough to play well with others. So it seems like instead of fighting them in a war, it would be probably a smarter thing to just take out their economy, you know, with everybody switching to different fuel sources, so they don't have any leg to stand on economically. That seems to be the smarter route to go than sacrificing thousands and thousands of lives over futile wars that don't make a difference and have such a long-term effect, you know, on societies. Because war does that, you know. It's not a thing of just the present. It affects generations after that, you know.
Right.
And it seems like in the time we're in now that there's people that are smart enough to come up with some new ways of doing things, you know, that are, I don't know, that have less consequences involved with them. So I'd probably pick, you know, people in the sciences and people in the developmental end of clean energy, things like that, to talk to, because I'm really interested in that.
Who from the past would you love to have?
Oh, there's thousands of those.
Yeah,
gosh. You know, I wouldn't mind hanging out with William Blake, you know.
Interesting.
Terrence McKenna, probably. Of more recent times, he was a brilliant guy, really onto something there, I think, with his interest in pharmacology and you know, kind of the evolution of human beings and how we got language, really, and how it's, you know, language is sort of the thing that, in his mind, at least, the thing that is kind of our limitation, in a sense. You know, language is what inspires us. It's what takes us to the next level. And once we can get past language, you know, we'll have a lot less limits to what we can do and accomplish. So I wouldn't mind picking his brain a little bit.
Always intriguing answers with you. You know, I mean, I'd love to sit down for an evening with Ben Franklin, but you come up with ones that are sort of off the beaten path. So,
I would say Franklin would be an interesting guy to hang out with for a while and get his perspective.
Absolutely, especially now with all the changes in how our Constitution's being represented and the stuff that's going on. And
yeah. You know, the thing about talking with people from the way past is that, you know, their mind, their worldview is so different, you know, than what ours is these days. But yet, quite a bit of what they came up with or what they thought has really shaped what we think and how we think, you know. Speaking of religion, for example, you know, like we hold these religious books like the Bible and the Quran, you know, we look at them as like this holy thing with all this great information in it, but yet a lot of it is written from the point of view of very primitive people, you know, and we've moved past that, so far past that now, but yet we still cling to some of those ideas in there as being so important, you know. But there are also people that thought that bleeding people was a way to make them healthy, you know. It's mm-hmm. ridiculous. You know, we look at that from a modern standpoint now. We think, what were they thinking? You know, idiots, you know, primitive people, you know. And so, you know, if you apply that same kind of idea to some of the other concepts they talk about, you know, you come up with the same conclusion. You know, it's primitive minds trying to explain big ideas, you know, and we've really moved past that now. We're into a whole different level of understanding our place in the world and the world in general, you know.
But as complicated as the world has become in the last century alone, isn't it sometimes nice to sort of go back to that simplistic thought process and just pare things away and say, you know what, this worked well then, why can't we use something like this now?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, you can definitely learn from the past, but you also have to put it in perspective as you know, where they were getting their information, you know, and how they were getting it. And so much of what we are and our way of doing things is really tainted by these very primitive religions that have been around and they influence our decisions even today. You know, for instance, I could take gay marriage, for example. You know, if you take the religious aspect out of it, there's no reason why gay people can't get married. You know, if you have a beef with that, it's because you're coming at it from a religious standpoint, you know. And so to me, religion, of course, is it's a very personal thing that people have and cling to. And so many of the world's religions have profited and got to where they are based on taking people in that were in dire straits, you know. People that didn't have, you know, a nickel to spend, people that were poor, people that were uneducated, and they use those people as pawns to get more strength and more political power, you know. And so much of that is based on, you know, people trying to take advantage of other people and push their agenda through, and building a consensus of people based upon ignorance.
Ladies and gentlemen, Jeff Tate of Queens right here with Metalholic on Mojo Radio. We want to thank you for taking the time, and we'll look forward to seeing you out on the cabaret tour and then dying for next year when the new album comes out.
Well, thanks for the interview. I appreciate it.
Go drink your green tea. Have a wonderful day. And as always, thanks for taking some time to talk with us.
Oh, you bet. Pleasure.
Take
Bye-bye.
Care.